I'll show you what I've done and where I'm at and why I'm at and how I got there. So I'll try and explain it now.
So first off, you saw the steels going in. This is dug out down to depth, ready for the type one stone hardcore. I calculated this depth. I didn't go into it because I've shown you how to use the laser before in a previous episode. So it's the same principle. So what I did, I got the finished floor level from inside the front door there. Chances are it's not going to be the same as the whole house, because the last time I did a job on a new build, it was like 35 mil difference in the finished floor levels all across the house. So, but it's something to aim for, because we've got a tolerance with our screed. So, you know, plus or minus X amount is not going to make any difference whatsoever. So what I did was I set the laser up, took a datum for the finished floor level on the inside, which is the screed, not the actual finished floor as in the laminate. I pulled a bit of laminate up, got the finished screed floor, put my laser on that wall there. And then the plans say we've got 65 mil of screed, a minimum of 100 mil Celotex. So that's 165. Then we have 150 mil concrete. Then we've got the 50 mil sand blinding, and then 150 mil of hardcore to go on top of this. So what I did was I added all those figures up and it came to 515, I think. So on my stick, I moved the laser detector up 515 mil and started at that end and dug down till I got the BPBPs, and then I've worked my way back. I dug out and found where I ran my corrugated twin wall to run my drainage through. I've chipped out to the crown of the pipe, so I've taken photos of that to give to the building inspector. I've done a rodent cover thing. So I cut that pipe, I cut enough cut a pipe on the same angle as that pipe, transferred it onto some cement board, drew around it, disced out the weird shape because it's like an ellipse, and then sliced it through the middle, put one underneath the pipe, one on top, sticky foam, boosh, bash, bosh, chippings against it, it's done. So that's that. And then while I'm waiting for the stone, I just need to scoop the bits that have fallen into that hole there, waterproof the bottom of my steel columns up to DPC height there, and also this one. So all my stones down, I've got my corners set up, ready to go in their correct positions. I don't need to show you how to do that because I've already shown you. We set the profiles up and it showed all our building lines. I marked this out last night when it was getting dark. Had to tweak this one slightly. I don't know if something's been knocked or moved. What I did first was I strung my lines, plumbed down with the level to mark the floor and join the dots. That corner was perfectly square, absolutely perfect. So what I did was I got my laser out. It fires two vertical beams at 90 degrees to each other. So I was able to, don't know if you can see, that's where I originally plumbed down from my string, but it wasn't square. So I tweaked my laser until it hit the line over there and very edge of that brickwork there, and I just meant I had to shimmy it over. So I'm guessing something's been knocked. It's not surprising, they've been up a while and a lot of machinery driving around it. So now they're where they need to be. I'm gonna chuck a mix on now. Oh my god, it's cold this morning and I got the lurgy. I can't string my interface because of that stupid post, so I'll just gauge it with the tape. If I leave these blocks nice where they're supposed to be, and then I can just gauge 325 mil to the inside face of my block work here. I set out my in 5-course down from the DPC because we're having an echo. I'm not sure what type yet, and obviously if my footing was too high then I wouldn't have been able to get my echoes in. So on the outside it's going to be 2-course of concrete commons and then 3-course of the nice Cassandras, which are FS2 bricks, by the way, before anyone says. On the inside is going to be 1-course of block and then 2-course of concrete common, which will bring us up to DPC.
Well, I'm not going to lie, it's bloody freezing. Can't see on there, I'm not being a fanny. Just got a mix on. Going to get these concrete commons up to DPC on the inner skin and then set out my corners for the outer skin. I'll crack on with it. So just what I show you, what I like to do when you're doing like face brick and you're coming up out of the ground, bring me a cup of tea. Morning. Ooh. I always like to dry bond my bricks just to make sure they work out to some sort of bond. So I'll show you now what I do, because start this on the one course below external ground level just to get all your imperfections out of the way. But if you do this, you don't need to, because it'll be right. So yeah, I'll show you what I'm up to now.
Because these bricks are all different sizes, I've measured them and they vary from like 220. I think the smallest one's about 202. I actually like to lay them out. And then once I've got my corners up and my string pull, I'll just lay one to the string where it sat. So I've got a little bit of a reference so you don't get all the way to the end and think, sugar daddy, I've got a 30 mil joint at the end. So this works out, it doesn't work out full bond. This works out reverse bond. So that means you start with a header and it ends on a full, that end. Same with this one, starts on a full brick and then ends on a half. And then this one starts on a full brick and ends on a half. So it's good to get that all set out before you get above ground level, basically, because you want all the issues ironed out before anyone can see. I mean, you can do it by measurements if you've got decent bricks that are all the same size. So I will actually use the exact brick that I've laid out. Right, let's get on with it.
Morning. I've ordered my concrete yesterday for Wednesday to do the and the pump to do the slab for this extension. So just thought I'd run you through what needs to happen before D-Day.
So put my 150 mil of hardcore. I've leveled it and raked it, and then using the laser level to dip it every now and then. I mean, it doesn't have to be absolutely perfect, but the flatter the better, really. And then I've whacked it down with the whacker, so that's all ready for the sand blinding layer. I made a start at the end of the day yesterday. Well, I'm 25 mil of sand. It's spec 50, but they just keep creeping it up, these architects. I don't know why. It used to be 10, then it went 25, and now it's bloody 50. So I'm doing 25, because at the end of the day, the only real reason for it is to stop it puncturing your damp-proof membrane. So basically, yeah, I just run a few batten screeds rails, drop my sand on, because you're aiming just for a nice consistent thickness of sand. Again, it doesn't have to be spot on level, just as flat as you can get it. I just start at the end, and as I'm filling, screeding it back with my level, pull the battens back and just fill in the little holes. Once the sand's done, it needs compacting again, and then we install the damp proof membrane then. I like to do it this way because it's easier. You can just install your 1200 gauge DPM up and into damp proof course there, but you have to have like a degree in flipping origami, man, and it's just annoying, and it's not as strong as this stuff, so it can tear. So what I like to do is put a bigger DPC in on the inside skin, and then what you do is you tuck your DPM, some quite simple folds, up under there and use the double-sided butyl tape, which waterproofs that lap. Then just make sure you lap it 150 mil. So I'll show you these stages as I'm going along.
Yeah, so when you've done, it should look a little something like this.
As you can see, you've got a nice consistent level of sand there. So I've just got to put a board across now and fill in these channels and then go over it with the whacker. I forgot to mention earlier as well, the makeup of your slab will depend on what the specification is on your drawing, obviously, and how you determine your depths. So, because on this job, I'm doing underfloor heating, so my insulation is going to go on top of my slab, not on the underneath my slab. If I was just going to do concrete to finish floor, my insulation would go under the slab. So the next thing to go on is the membrane now. Then it'll be my 150 mil concrete. Then it'll be my insulation on top of that, followed by the underfloor heating, followed by 50 mil of flow screed then. But yeah, I'll keep showing you the process as we go along. Hope that helps.
like cavity trays at DPC level. There's not a great deal online about this, and I don't 100% agree with the diagrams you get from, like, you know, your NHPC standards and all that. So I'll show you how I've done it and how I do it and how I've been doing it for years. It's been okay by every single building inspector since. So in fact, they prefer it, actually. So I'll show you what I do. I think it's easier. But judge for yourself, I guess. Everyone's different, and there's loads of ways of doing everything, so I don't want to start a war. I'm just showing you what I do. So there we are. Anyway, here we go.
So I got my concrete come in tomorrow. So I've got all my DPM down, held up against the wall. It's all been taped with the double-sided butyl tape. That's important. Don't rely on just, like, duct tape, because it ain't waterproof, so yeah, always use that underneath your laps, and then I go over the top then, just to keep down all the flappy edges with the cloth tape afterwards. Just looks neater. So obviously this laps up to your DPC course, and then what I do then is some people do it on the first block, and they do it so any water comes down, but it comes out then at DPC level, and that's the bit I don't agree with, because basically, if you imagine water does, not that it should, and to be honest, you've probably got bigger problems if that's happening. But if water should come down this cavity, the water would run down the cavity tray and sit at DPC level. So I argue that that actually breaches the DPC, because if those holes ever get blocked, or, you know, it doesn't drain properly, because your weep holes are every 900. So if a water all gets stuck behind you, it's gonna breach the damp proof and start soaking up your wall past your damp proof, if you see what I mean. So I always do it the brick below. So this isn't damp proof course yet. The next course of brick is damp proof. So obviously you've got to put your course in blocks somewhere to get your 2.1 door height. So I just think, why not do it at the start? So I put my course in blocks on first. Then my damp tray now will go over here, down there, over my insulation, down the face of it, and then onto this course where I will put weep holes in. And then when I lay the next course up to DPC, I'll put another four inch DPC on there. So what I just explained could happen, can't happen, and I know it's probably not a big deal or whatever, but it might cause problems, say, I don't know, for your render, if your bottom of your render is getting wet or whatever. So I don't know, I just prefer doing it this way. And another thing is your insulation then. This first piece of insulation goes below your finished floor. So again, that's massively helping towards avoiding cold bridging, because they only specified 25 mil perimeter insulation, don't they? So in theory, you've got 75 there. I'll show you the rest of the process as I've done it. Just going to go and pick up some oil tape to tape all my joints. And what I would do, obviously you can't get your insulation clips on you. So what I do then is I use like a hybrid polymer, any type, X8, OB1, blah de blah. There's millions of them on the market now, aren't there? And I'll stick the back of that to this block, wedge it with some bricks till it goes off. And then to get back up to normal then, the offcuts of these that I ripped down on my table saw over there will get used to do like a wedge piece here. And then that obviously gets kept on with your insulation retaining clip when you start the next course. And then you're back to normal 450 cavity bats then, and everything should work out. So that's all the insulation stuck and taped on all the joints. Next step now is to start forming my cavity tray with some 450 mil DPC. So I'll show you that next. When you've done your actual tray, it should look something like this. Obviously here where the steel is, I'm going to do a lap there, just because it was too awkward off one big piece. So I'll do a 150 lap there, 150 lap there, and trim it round there. The trickiest bit is on your corners, but should look, by the time you get your double-sided tape on all of this, it should look nice and neat. I'm going to just finish off this last little bit now. If you want, I'll show you how I cut these corners. Yeah, so with these folds, obviously there's one going underneath. What I did on this one is exactly the same as I'm going to do on this one. So we've just tucked this little upstand, tidied that up. What I'm going to do now is you always fold it the way you're facing. So as I'm looking down there, basically that crease, you want to fold it straight and slice from the point where it meets the insulation there out to the end. So I'll do that. So I've done that slice there, as that's the point there. And then a bit easier if we put a brick there. And then you cut then again from where you can feel the insulation, cut it through there. So now I've got them two cuts. So that laps over that. that tucked round under there, and then that, things like that. And then you can trim. And there you have it. That's the corner done. And then obviously under each lap, you want to put some double-sided butyl tape. And then what I do is then I go over it with the cloth tape just to tidy it all up. And jobs are good in. Obviously, there's a weak point under there. So definitely get a bit of tape underneath that corner. So that's about the only place it could possibly get through. But it is lapped and lapped again. One thing I'll say is, obviously, this is where the doorway is. So my next course will go under there. Make sure. So there's going to be a perp there. That cavity closed. You turn up and form an upstand at the end, and then that will get hidden in the perp then of that brick. And then obviously the insulation will sit on there, and then stop the insulation shy to allow for your cavity closer. Then on the ends, you want to turn it up. It's just a nice neat little fold so that it runs out, and then there'll be a weep hole there. I'm just using the buff weep holes to match our mortar colour-ish. But yeah, they'll look all right, won't they? So yeah, that's how I do my cavity trays.
Well, good morning. It's a beautiful morning today. Concrete's coming today. It's about 8:30. They're coming at 9. Well, the pump's coming at 9, I think, to set up. And then the wagon will be at 8:30. I've moved house since the last time I did a slab. And could I find my wellies this morning? Could I, hell? So, let's go and buy a bloody new pair. I can't stand wearing wellies, so they better fit. It'd be nice, because they make my feet hurt. Poor doggy. Right, well, I'll show you what all I've really got left to do. I'm pretty well prepared, I think, but, you know, famous last words. So I'll just talk you through what I got to do before they come.
Pretty much all ready. I went round yesterday, just as a visual aid, so I got my laser. I don't know if you can see that, marking the top of concrete height. It's only just to help to see, because the last thing you want is to go too high and then your underfloor heating's, your screed for your underfloor heating's not thick enough. The optimum for this flow screed is 50 mil apparently, so that's what I've set this out to now. I got some foam roll. I'm just going to tape some foam roll across the base of them steels to give it some room to move, around the bottom of this steel as well to give that room to move. Set all my levels yesterday and I drew round, see that? I drew round my laser. So all I gotta do is set my laser up on that pencil drawing there, and my staff's already set up there, look, with my detector. So yeah, and get me wellies on. So I'll crack on with that. So we've stuck our separation foam on there, lasers all set up, and the pump shirt, and they're just setting up their pipe now. So just got to wait for the big wagon to come now with the concrete on. So, it was a success. No dramas. So that's the finished product. Apologies for the terrible quality of the time lapses. I don't know what happened. It must use a different camera to this one. I told the customer, just in case, to when this sets up, to sheet it over this afternoon to protect it from drying out too quick. It's getting quite hot now with the sun. But yeah, it's bang on with the laser all the way around. And I thought I'd mention as well that even though this isn't the finished floor, make sure you do spend time getting this, you know, as level as possible with your laser and as flat as possible with your dapple bar, because your insulation is going to sit on top of this and you don't want any undulations really, because you're going to cause deflection in the floor. So the flatter the better, really. Yeah, I'm going to call it a day for today.